Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. The 51st Arizona State Legislature goes to work in less than 2 weeks on January 14th. Tomorrow, the House Speaker and Senate President will be here to tell us what they hope to accomplish this session. But tonight, we hear from community leaders, advocates representing children, education, health care, and the business community. Here to tell us what they want lawmakers to focus on is Amy Kobeta, Vice President of Children's Action Alliance, Tara Plesch, Director of Government and Media Relations for the Arizona Association of Community Health Centers, Glenn Hammer, President and CEO of the Arizona Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and Andrew Morrill, President of the Arizona Education Association. Good to have you all here. Thank you so much for joining me.
Great to be here.
Let's lay some groundwork here. The state of your individual areas of expertise. We'll start with kids' child welfare. What are we seeing out there right now?
Well, sadly, Arizona's children are really dealing with a lot of struggles. Arizona's families are dealing with so many struggles, and we haven't really seen a tremendous amount of leadership from the legislature in terms of providing those supports that kids need. We're reading more and more accounts of children who are in the foster care system who are not able to get the help that they need. We're seeing backloads of cases in child protective services. We're seeing education cuts, child care cuts, and so it's very challenging right now for Arizona's families and kids.
The state of health care issues in Arizona, what do we got?
A huge challenge ahead of us with health care issues. Initially, before CMS brought down their decision on whether or not we could just expand to 100% of the federal poverty level, it looked like we had a good opportunity to restore funding for what they're called childless adults, which is about 250,000 people who've lost their coverage. Now with that off the table, because CMS said that they would have to expand to the full 133%, we're looking at maybe not expanding at all if the legislature so chooses. But that's gonna be our challenge this year, is making sure we expand coverage for approximately 500,000 Arizonans.
And I want to get to more on that in a second here, defining terms and exactly what the options are for the state. Okay. But before we get to that, the state of business in Arizona right now.
Ted, we're on the move. I'd argue that in the last 2 years, the governor and our friends in the legislature have accomplished more than any other state. I'm talking all, you take a look at the 50 states and you take a look at what we've been able to achieve in terms of making our tax code more competitive, our civil justice environment more competitive, our regulatory reform environment more competitive, and we believe we've also made a lot of progress in the field of education as well. And what does this all mean? Chief Executive Magazine now has us as a top 10 state. The Kauffman Foundation ranks us as the most entrepreneurial state in the country. You know, we think that the Arizona Commerce Authority is really doing a great job. Their last report that came out a couple of months ago was off the charts good in terms of new jobs created. We've turned a corner in this state, and we need to keep on doing the types of things that will continue to make this a more attractive state to do business.
Andrew, education.
We want to turn that corner with business in Arizona. We're not there yet. We have half a business plan that we're operating by in our schools. What we've done is increased the standards for students. We're educating and we're going to educate students to higher academic standards. I think everybody in the education community applauds that. We're going to bring in assessments that are going to test them better and smarter, frankly. We're tying that student growth now to teacher and principal evaluation, and we're rating schools across the state and districts with more emphasis on student learning and student growth than ever before. What we haven't done, Ted, is match the outcomes with an investment strategy that's going to make that work. So any business leader knows, once you identify where you want to go, you've got to bring the investments to bear. We haven't done that yet.
Okay, let's talk about investment strategies with each areas of concern here. We'll start again with kids. Funding cuts in the past, the impact of those cuts on child welfare.
Well, if you want to just look at child care and early child care, early childhood education and access for working families to find quality child care for their kids, you're looking at 22,000 kids who have been turned away since they've frozen those cuts. You're talking about thousands of kids who are going without health care since they've frozen kids care. And you're talking about a record number of kids being in the foster care system and record caseloads with child protective services.
Are you seeing increased demands for all of those things?
Absolutely, without a doubt.
So do you see in this next session in particular restoration of cuts at all likely?
Well, my concern is that we're going to get back to the legislature and we're going to start with a flurry of guns in schools. And we're going to spend the first month talking about whether or not to have officers or volunteers with guns on our campuses. And we're really not going to spend the time talking about what are our funding priorities. Where do we go with the surplus that is anticipated at the end of fiscal year 13? We're looking at $676 million surplus at the end of this fiscal year. According to JLBC, we have $450 million in the rainy day fund. And so we would like to see a conversation about where does that money go, how does that money support kids, and how does it keep families together?
Well,
that concern is really widespread across the education community. We need to approach the priorities in education across the state to reflect a good business environment by bringing a stable and progressive workforce out of our schools to support business in the future. But we've seen a legislature in the past get distracted early on. I mean, we've had legislatures distract themselves with a state dinosaur, with a state model of gun. I'm very concerned that we're going to push aside some of the priority conversations we ought to be having. The relationship of children's health to education, the relationship of education and business, and become distracted in somebody's idea, probably an extreme idea, about how to immediately handle safety on our campuses.
Tara, how do we approach this when we don't even know? I mean, you mentioned numbers here. We think we know what the rainy day fund is. We think we know what JLBC said. But with health care concerns, especially dealing with Medicaid and expanded coverage and these sorts of things, is it a moving target out there? How do we know what we really got?
Well, I think that it's also an investment. And one of the things that is often overlooked is that healthcare is a necessity, but it's also a business. And with all the big cuts, we basically cut $1.5 billion out of the healthcare industry in the last year. But that has really profoundly impacted, negatively impacted hospitals and primary care providers like my health centers, where 65% of their patients are Medicaid. If you get those better reimbursements, there's more investment in the community. And in some parts of the state, our health centers are the only provider for 200 square miles or more. And so without that kind of investment in our health care and public safety, I might add, because as we go back to the gun issue, we're talking about lack of funding for mental health services, which is part of the overall equation. So for a relatively low investment, like $1.5 billion over the next 3 years, we can draw down over $8 billion of federal funding if we agree, if we, the state, agrees to expand 133%.
Healthcare is an extraordinarily important part of our state's economy. It's been an area that the hospitals in particular have been hit very hard by uncompensated care. And what that does is it puts pressure not just on the hospitals, but it puts pressure on insurance premiums. It increases the price of premiums. We call it the hidden healthcare tax. And what it does is it makes it more difficult for businesses, particularly small businesses, to afford health insurance. So, you know, this upcoming session, dealing with the uncompensated care issue is extremely important, and we'll be, I'm sure, working together on some solutions in that area.
And before we get too far along on what happens, especially with the Medicaid issue, lay the groundwork. Where are we at right now with Medicaid possible expansion? What are the options there? What do our viewers need to know about that particular aspect, since it's going to be discussed an awful lot in the legislature?
Well, I think one of the key components of that is if we go ahead and restore the Prop 204 population, which, not to be confused with the most recent initiative for children, but it was an initiative that actually was passed by the voters on two separate occasions, which basically ensured that people up to 100% of the federal poverty level, which is about $15,000 a year for an individual and about $30,000 a year for a family of four, that they would get Medicaid coverage. In essence, they would have health care coverage. Right now, one in five Arizonans does not have health care coverage. So that's where the uncompensated care comes in to that. But if we can take advantage of this and pull down additional funding, we're basically, it's an investment that I think could really infuse a lot of capital in Arizona.
I think what you see represented among the four interest areas here is a hope that the legislature will avoid some of the extremism that really slowed us down in past legislative sessions. It was the business community not too long ago that went to the legislature when immigration became not just the number one priority issue, but an invitation for one extremist agenda after another. And it was business leaders that came back to the legislature and said, enough. I think we're looking for that same thing in our education approach, in our approach to children's and health issues, to try to keep us this legislature aligned with the priorities of voters.
Define extremism, though, because some people would see extremism as something that needs to be addressed.
I think when the Daily Show parks a van outside the capital of Arizona,